Beer is like sunshine for the belly.
I'm excited to introduce our first guest, ancient ales expert, beer archaeologist, professor of Greek and Roman archaeology, art history, Egyptology, Roman history, and anthropology. And he's also the former research and development manager at Avery Brewing behind the Ales of Antiquity series. Hello, Travis Rupp, and thanks so much for joining the show today. Don't you do?
Thank you for having me on. And yeah, I know. I ended up wearing a lot of hats over the last several years. And so, and I still kind of wear all those hats, I guess. So yes.
Yeah, you've got quite the repertoire.
Oh, thank you.
So you're a professor at the University of Colorado Boulder. That's actually my in-law's alma mater. I'm very familiar with Boulder. And I see you just announced a mechanical engineering class that you're teaching called Food and Alcohol in the Ancient World. Tell us more about what made you want to focus on the history of beer.
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, in regards to wearing all those hats I've had and things over the years, I didn't ever think that my paths were going to cross like this. I graduated from CU Boulder in 2010, and I was primarily a Roman archaeologist, a Roman art historian at the time. So I was working mostly on second century architecture and sculpture, nothing related to beer. But I had, as it goes in the academic world, I was only teaching a couple of classes at the beginning. And so I got a job at Avery Brewing Company. My girlfriend, who's now my wife, so that all worked out great, she was the one who encouraged me to do it because I'd always been really interested in beer and brewing. I'd been home brewing since I was 19 with my dad, you know, so started way back in the day. And I actually started as a bartender at Avery. And then worked my way up pretty quickly. I was moved into production about, I think it was about 8 months or so later, and worked in production at Avery for about 8 years or so. But while I was at Avery, a lot of the staff were like, well, you're a teacher, you can teach anything, teach us about beer history. And I didn't have any background in beer history. So they would throw out these random topics to me that they wanted me to explore. And as I did start digging into it more, I started to realize that my world in academia, which was in the ancient world, there just wasn't much written about ancient alcohol production. And the things that were written, I started to notice were taking some fairly like sweeping generalizations sweeping generalizations about what ancient beer might have been like. And being a brewer then at that point and knowing what the brewing process looked like, I decided to start digging into it more deeply. And in 2015 was really when the aha moment happened. My wife and I were in Greece, and we'd been in Turkey and Greece for a little over a month. We were actually on our honeymoon, but she's an academic as well, so we can't stop doing research and things like that. And I found some pretty firm evidence to support that the Greeks did in fact brew beer, which most books said that they didn't. And at that point, I'm like, I really need to just turn my focus to this. And so since 2015, I'd been working on beer history since about 2012, but in 2015 is when I decided to go all in and really focus on ancient alcohol production and now food production as well with my new course that I'm offering at the University of Colorado.
Fascinating. Yeah, I found out when I was doing some research for the story that happens right before this interview, actually. Yeah there was a very little mention of beer in Greece. I basically read that most of the historical record is having to do with wine, and they weren't huge fans of Greece or huge fans of beer in Greece. And I found that really interesting, especially like, you know, Romans conquered everything. Romans were into beer. And yeah, it's right. It's wild that there's such a gap in the historical record for something that's so prevalent.
Absolutely. Totally agree. I mean, that's kind of what where I got hung up, because you look at all these other ancient civilizations that surround Greece. And to your point, you know, the Romans write about beer. We know the Egyptians mass produced beer. It was a big thing in the ancient Near East as well. And I just thought it was very strange that this one area didn't have it at all. And so I started doing a lot of talks, a lot of public talks on the for homebrewers, as well as for academics and for museums on the topic. And then what was really nice was in 2018, my theory was actually proven by an archaeological dig in northern Greece, where they actually did find an ancient Bronze Age brewery. And I think they're all over the place. And so I'm continuing my work on that still. So
yeah, that must be very satisfying to have your theories proven.
Big time, because I mean, some of my opponents out there, and there aren't very many, there are only a couple other individuals that work on ancient beer, but they definitely were just, they're like, no, it's just way too speculative. And then when it was proven, it was a good feeling. There's not many people, they're not really bashing my argument anymore, which is nice. So yeah.
That's wonderful. Yeah. So you've also developed beers based on George Washington's preferred porter and a beer based on Thomas Jefferson's estate, beer brewed at Thomas Jefferson's estate to honor enslaved brewer Peter Hemmings and mm-hmm. the other enslaved brewers in Monticello. What kind of research went into finding out what these beers were like back then?
Sure. So one thing that I do kind of a side project, and hopefully down the road I'll get an opportunity to write a book on this, is revolutionary American brewing, because I've always been kind of, it's been a hobby, revolutionary America, I've always found interesting. And so I just kind of read that stuff on the side. But what is very different about studying that era of beer is that there's a lot of information. So as opposed to what I normally do, where there's no literary references whatsoever, or we don't have recipes, or we're scrounging to find the facilities where it was produced, we know kind of all that stuff already from the early colonies. But at the same time, we weren't much of a beer producing country when we first formed ourselves. You know, the early colonies were primarily consuming rum. They were still importing large quantities of beer from England, even during the war. And so it was a multifaceted approach to the study. I did spend quite a bit of time in archives. I worked at the Monticello archives for a while, also at the Fred W. Smith Archives at Mount Vernon, digging through documents. And the cool thing, I didn't really expect to have this opportunity, but I was literally handling letters that George Washington wrote, or his cousin who was taking care of Mount Vernon wrote to him. It's interesting. I mean, I've held things that are thousands of years old, and I'd never like had this weird feeling like I did when you're holding a document that you know one of the founding fathers actually handled themselves. But there's quite a bit of evidence in the literature, but because we have so much information in those archives, a lot of people have never looked at it. It gets donated to these archives, and then it just ends up in an archive forever until somebody asks to look at it. Mm-hmm. And so as I started to comb through that, I started to realize there was a lot of evidence for beer production. So then I started branching out and talking to other experts in the area. Steve Bashore, who is the head distiller at Mount Vernon. So he's still distilling whiskey on the estate in the same location that George Washington was doing it. He really helped me out and talked me through the process of how he was able to reconstruct the whiskey. And of course, whiskey has to start out as beer originally anyway. So making a lot of connections in the area, but then also just spending a lot of time in the area, spent a fair quantity of time in Philadelphia doing research on Benjamin Franklin. And he was quite the porter consumer himself, and supposedly arguably is the one that got George Washington into good porter. And so it's a very multifaceted, kind of eclectic approach to the study. By the time I'm done looking at ledgers, talking to experts, spending time on the ground and actually looking at facilities, looking at drawings. I mean, Thomas Jefferson actually was drafting up a brewery. He had planned and made plans for a brewery at Monticello, just never came to fruition. So once I put all of that together, And then look at a lot of cookbooks, to be honest, because, you know, brewing back then was primarily a woman's trade. And there are a lot of cookbooks and housewife manuals and things that had recipes in them. And you can really layer it back together, piece it back together. But one thing that I've always tried to stay authentic to is the process. I've been asked before, you know, well, if you just recreate ancient beers, right? So you just find recipes and then recreate them. Well, anybody can do that. That's not the hard part. The hard part is the process, trying to brew it the way they did with the equipment they had, under the conditions they were brewing, storing it the way they stored it, because that's all going to affect the outcome, as you know, mm-hmm. very well. And so that's the part that gets really, really interesting. And it was really, honestly, an honor. The last Ale of Antiquity I did at Avery before I left was Monticello, in honorance of Peter Hemmings, a man who we don't know what he looked like. Almost nothing. We know almost nothing about the man because he was enslaved at Monticello, yet he was the beer producer. Jefferson gets all this credit for being a brewer, but I highly doubt that the man ever actually brewed a batch of beer in his life. There were other people doing it for him. And so to give a tip of the hat to Peter Hemmings, who actually brewed a really, really interesting beer, a persimmon beer at the estate, was a lot of fun. Really, really cool.
Yeah, that's fascinating. It's so fortunate that, you know, when you go back to that level, you can actually find the recipes. It's kind of crazy.
Yeah.
Going back even further, you've recreated beers based on what Vikings were drinking and a beer that was from the Israeli, Palestinian, and Jordanian region around the same time that Alexander the Great was conquering the region. Mm-hmm. So there can't be many primary sources when you go back that far in history. Is the process you use to develop the more ancient beers different from the ones that occurred in this millennium?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. And yes, it is. Where, you know, with Jefferson, Jefferson's estate, and then George Washington, even when I recreated the quote original India Pale Ale, there's a lot of literary material to reference. And you can kind of go into bookworm mode for a long period of time, just looking at references to that kind of stuff. But when you go back that far, you know, with the Vikings, there are no Viking cookbooks. You know, the actual Viking expeditions that were undertaken happened centuries before anything was written down in terms of a food source manual. And so I rely heavily on archaeological evidence for that. The same is true looking at the beer that came from the Palestinian, Jordanian, Israeli region. In those instances, I'm having to comb through a lot of data that comes from site reports, but also archaeobotanical and archaeochemical analysis, because we find vessels and we have ideas of potentially what they were being used for. And we're looking for oxalates inside the vessels that would have formed during the brewing process. And they are fairly specific oxalates that aren't created during a wine fermentation process, for example. And so we're having to look for that very scientific data to prove that that was what was being produced there. At the same time, I will say that there are instances where I can dive into the literature, though, because there are a lot of terms in ancient Hebrew or Latin or Greek that we don't know exactly what they are. There are, you know, ideas of potentially what they might have been. And in the case of Beersheba, the ancient Israeli beer, I was looking fairly extensively at this one term called, it goes by different translations of shikar or shikru, but it's basically this alcoholic beverage that's often listed with wine, but it's not wine. Otherwise, they would just call it wine. And so reaching out to scholars, especially when it comes to Hebrew, that know the language better than I do, philologists that can really help me with the etymology, because I know Latin and Greek, but I'm an archaeologist. I don't work on language all the time. And so sometimes the language can come in, but really I rely heavily on archaeology and then art history as well. That's the really fun part about the anthropology side that comes in and the art historical side, is I love looking for artistry that depicts drinking or floral or flora, on vessels, you know, whether it be grapes or some kind of barley or other cereals. Clearly those items were important to those people enough to put them in the artistry. And I think that's telling of potentially what they were consuming and producing as well. And then the last piece of it is traveling as much as I do and working in these areas. There is a layer of ethnographic study that goes into play as well, because though, you know, when I worked on the very first Ale of Antiquity, Nestor's Cup, which was a Mycenaean beer, though that beer dates, you know, some 3,200 or so years ago, you can still go to Greece and experience the culture and realize that a lot of those things that were rooted in the distant past haven't gone away. The way they cook their food, the foods that they focus on, their celebration of the grape and the olive, those are things that have been around for millennia. And studying the ethnographic kind of lay of the land is still very important to trying to reconstruct those ancient beers as well. And so it's a lot of fun. You know, again, it's just multiple layers that come into play to try to recreate it and try to give some individuals something tangible from history that they can experience. And I will say with that, I will never boast that I can fully recreate an ancient beer. You know, I don't think anybody can, to be honest. And you as a brewer know this, there are just way too many variables at play. You know, you and I could come up with the exact same recipe and both brew it exact same time, try to recreate the conditions, we get together and drink it, and they're not going to taste the same. And that's the artistry that's at play with beer, because it never, that's why it's more than just getting a recipe and recreating it. Mm-hmm. There are all those variables that change it. And so I get as close as I can by recreating the process. But I don't know if I'll ever be able to 100% recreate an ancient beer.
Yeah, I always tell people I share all my recipes, because even if you brew the exact same beer and hit everything exactly, it's going to taste different no matter what. So absolutely, you can't drink the beer that I'm making.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's right. You know, it's a living organism, you know, yeah. And that's wonderful about it, you know?
Yeah. 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 It's just so multifaceted. That's why I think why I love it so much.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So while trying to recreate some of these ancient ales, which beer did you find to be the most difficult to brew? And what types of hurdles have you faced during the brewing process, and any major failures you're open to sharing?
Sure. I can tell you for certainty, the hardest one of the 10 that I did while I was at Avery was 1752 India Pale Ale. And people are usually pretty surprised when I say that, because they think it's going to be, you know, the Greek beer or the ancient Mycenaean beer or the Viking beer or something along those lines. And the 1752 India Pale Ale was the hardest because of the process, again, that had to be undertaken. So when I came back and brewed, for example, the monastic beers after I was with the monks in Italy in 2017, yeah, there were hurdles. There were strange things that we had to enact to recreate this 9th-century beer. But that brewing process is pretty much still the standard process we undertake today. With 1752 India Pale Ale, I had to figure out how to recreate the conditions of brewing a beer in London and then shipping it to India in Colorado. So that's a really hard thing to do, because the reason obviously that IPA became what it was just pale ale that was shipped to India. That's where the title comes from, right? And so in order to recreate that process, we replicated water chemistry from the Thames, all of that stuff. All of the brewing conditions were exactly the same. Recipe was exactly the same as George Hodgson had recorded for his beer at Bow Brewing. And then I had to figure out how to put it in barrels, get it on a boat, and sail it for a minimum of 3 months to India. And so in order to do that, what I did, and I spent weeks going through this, I had to figure out how many nautical miles it was, what the temperature fluctuations were at the ideal time of year, because if India Pale Ale does in fact come from the October ale style that we think it did, most of that beer was produced for export in October. So I had to map what the water conditions were leaving London, and then how many weeks it would take to get to the equator, what the gradual increase in water temperature would be to get there, and then the decrease again to go around the Cape of Good Hope, and then again through the Indian Ocean up to India. It was intense, because what we did, we absolutely abused that beer. I was surprised after I took on the project. I'm like, what am I doing? I've got to sell this beer. When it's done, it's going to taste terrible. That's what I thought, because we absolutely abused it. I left headspace in the barrels to promote oxidation, because I knew that it was going to oxidize like crazy in the journey. And then we rocked the barrels. We actually shook them for a 3-month period to mimic travel on an open sea. And some of those journeys were 2 years long. This was just the shortest trip that they could take. And then we did fluctuate temperature as well. So it went through multiple temperature swings from roughly 42 Fahrenheit all the way up to about 86, 87 Fahrenheit and back down. And this is an IPA, right? So this is like absolute no-no all the way around what you're doing. And it was dry hopped, all that. And it was interesting because it was a very interesting study, because as we brought the temperature back up to get to the equator, it started fermenting again. It actually did carbonate in the barrel. So I'd always been asked, would these beers have carbonated? And I presume they would have, but only if they can get, you know, a restarted fermentation. Well, we proved it with this study that it can happen. And so by the end of it, it was a very laborious process. I will tell you, there were times where my colleagues that worked with me on the project, we were damn near in tears tasting those barrels, because they tasted awful when they got to the equator. But I'll be damned if by the time it got to India, in Colorado, they actually tasted pretty good. It was a very, very hazy IPA. Not at all what I expected. Not very hoppy, even though the IBUs on it were about 40. But it's all old world hops, very earthy, dirty, and the oak really took over. And so it was interesting. It was a fun experiment, you know, to show that the original IPA is not what we think of as an IPA today. But that was by far the most difficult, because it was a lot of manual labor on a daily basis to make sure we stayed true to the production stream, the process stream. And then the worry that it wouldn't be palatable when it was done, but it actually was. And it was an interesting piece of education for the public, as I talked through kind of what's happened with the trends of hazy IPAs and things, for them to see what the original IPAs might have been like. In regards to your other part of the question, failures, most certainly there have been all kinds of things that have gone awry. I mean, when I did the Viking beer, we got massive sulfur production that we just did not expect, because we used baker's yeast, because the Vikings most certainly were doing that. We're just using their bread starters to start their beer, and baker's yeast just acts very, very differently than brewer's yeast does. It stays heavily in suspension. We expected, you know, a lot of the sulfur to blow off, and it took a long time for us to get rid of the sulfur. But people loved it by the time it went away. We just weren't expecting such long tank residency on it. With the ancient monastic beers, there were two pieces to that. One was that I brought yeast back from the monasteries, and getting that through customs was a nightmare, because they're like, what in the hell is this stuff? You have 8 bottles of this slurry. And, that was interesting. I did get it into the country though. Also, I needed to cut down a juniper tree for that, and I had bought one online through Etsy to be shipped to Colorado, and the guy who was harvesting it broke his leg like 2 weeks before he was supposed to ship it, and it never came. So I had to go hunting for somebody in a nearby community, and this one guy's like, please cut down this juniper tree in my yard. You can have it. So I didn't get one from Sweden. I wanted to. But I went out, there are pictures of me and my guys dragging this tree back down the street from the neighborhood, to make, one of the ancient monastic beers. So lots of interesting things along the way, kind of shots in the dark I had to take at times, because certainly the record's not full, otherwise everybody I think would be doing this. And so having to take some artistic license and just hope for the best. But yeah, it's been really interesting in those regards, for sure.
Yeah, I never would have thought about the journey that the IPA had to take to be kind of be authentic.
Yeah.
That's that blew my mind. Man.
It was just unbelievable. I mean, I still think about that process a lot. Mainly because I mean it's just and there were things again, even with that I had to just take a shot because when it comes to temperatures, it depended on whether the beer hold was below waterline or above waterline, right? Because the temperature is going to be different if it's below the waterline or above. I looked at multiple schematics of shipping vessels from the East India Trading Company. Some had it below the waterline, some had it below, some above, some had it right at the waterline. So it's like, well, I guess I'll go with this one. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's just interesting, all those variables that could have changed the beer outcome, you know?
Yeah, it's such a shot in the dark. That's just wild.
Yeah.
So you're writing a book, Brewing in the Ancient World. I can't wait to get a copy. It's my new fascination. I'm obsessed with brewing in the ancient world now. Can you tell us a little bit about what the readers can expect given your travels and experience doing research on the topic? And what do you hope the beer industry takes from this book?
Yeah, absolutely. So, and that with the book, it's been in the works for so many years. And that's the nice thing now that I'm much more focused on the academic side. Now that I'm not with Avery anymore, I'm focusing more on getting this book done because a lot of my followers have been like, Jesus, you've been at this for years. When is it going to be done? So hopefully I can really crank through this and get it done in the next couple of years because the project has gotten so big that I need to now focus it a little bit. So the first book that comes out is going to focus very intently on beer production on the Roman boundaries, basically. And so a lot of coming back to my roots as a Romanist, I have been exploring a lot of what the Romans thought of beer. Obviously, they write about beer, but a lot of those contexts are usually negative or they see it as very much kind of this thing that other people consume. And we have to remember that a lot of those literary sources too are from elite Romans that, they're always going to have their pinky up and drinking a glass of wine, right? While they're poo-pooing what the other peasants get to drink. And so I've been very curious about that. And so a lot of my travels as of late have been in Roman occupied Britain, Roman occupied Germany, doing a lot of work in Egypt as well, in Turkey, and looking at what that interaction looked like because though the upper crust of Rome poo-pooed beer, they write about it, but they don't really seem to like it too much. We know that the Roman military consumed it in vast quantities. So the Romans did consume beer. And so that's what the first book is going to really explore that and look at what that relationship looked like between the Romans and the boundary peoples, the barbarians, as they would have called them. But also what the production looked like. So we are talking probably about industrial scale brewing that is preserved in some of the archaeological record. And so what I hope to do is recreate what that looked like and explore what industrial brewing looked like, you know, in anywhere from the second century BC to the second to fourth century CE and give kind of a fuller picture. I think that also what I'm hoping the brewing world can get out of that is looking at kind of the roots of brewing. And that's kind of what the goal has been with the Ales of Antiquity series in general is we, having worked at an industrial facility, it's all about perfect quality, perfect consistency. And that's what the beer market calls for today. But are we right to just assume that the ancients didn't care about that? You know what I mean? With my new class on food and alcohol in the ancient world that I'm teaching for the mechanical engineering program, day one, we talked about that there are a lot of assumptions that have been made about ancient food, that it must have been unpalatable, that it was purely for sustenance, that quality and flavor didn't matter. Well, I think that's just a very obtuse statement to make and that no, they cared about what they were drinking. And quality was very much key. In Roman Britain, we have texts where they're actually saying, get beer from that guy because he's the good brewer, or bring in more guys like the brewer Atrectus. He's a really good cerveisarius and this kind of thing. And so that's what the first book is going to explore. And then hopefully it will spawn into a lot of other projects. I do have a project going on ancient monastic brewing. sure many you and many of your viewers are familiar with Stan Hieronymus. Stan Hieronymus is a very good friend of mine and kind of my mentor in the beer writing world. Wrote the book on hops, and he's written books on wheat and then Brew Like a Monk. And he's really encouraged me to go further back than his book Brew Like a Monk did and look at ancient traditions. So I've been working on that. And then also Revolutionary America is something I hope to be working on in the near future as well.
That's great. I hope that you have a whole series on ancient beers. I will read all of them.
Thank you.
It's so fun to dive into and just kind of mind blowing, like how far back it goes it's astounding to me that it's basically as humans have grown, like beer's kind of always been there.
Yep. Absolutely. I mean, you said it, that's exactly what I say often is just that I think beer makes us human. I mean, you look at every culture and it's there. And the beauty about beer is that it's a very social beverage. I think it really should be credited for driving a lot of humanity's achievements. I mean, as I think I've been on record saying a couple of times, it's going to make me sound like an alcoholic, but I like wine. I love wine and I love spirits. You know, I drink pretty much anything, but they all have their own mood, right? You know, wine is kind of an intimate thing with maybe one or a couple other people. When I sit back with a glass of scotch at night, I don't want to talk to anybody. But when it comes to beer, you know, you sit down with large quantities of people sometimes and have 2, 3, 4 of them. And it's a very social beverage. And I think it's really driven humanity in a lot of ways. And I think now's a great time to see more people hopefully getting interested in ancient food or beer history, because we're not really all that different than they were. And I think getting at the roots and at the core of humanity, look at the average guy and what they were doing. We focus too often on royalty. Don't get me wrong, they're super interesting. And I teach a lot of stuff on Roman imperial entities and royalty. But the average guy, I think, is just as interesting, if not more interesting, than those highfalutin elites from our past.
Yeah, it's easier to kind of see yourself in them.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So for an upcoming episode, I'm focusing on yeast found in weird places, and rumor has it that you would love to resurrect ancient yeast from Antarctic ice cores. Can you share a little bit more about that?
Sure. Yeah, it was kind of this white whale question I got asked a couple of years ago of what is the craziest thing that, you know, you would want to do? And there are a lot of things on my list, but one thing that is of interest to me, because I'm doing a lot of research right now, one of my topics for exploration in 2021 is really getting to the roots of where this all started. Because those questions get asked all the time. How old is beer? You know, did it come before bread? Was it really safer to drink than water? All these things. And so as I keep digging into it, you know, the record keeps getting pushed further and further back for how old these things are. But I wonder just really how old the living organism is that we use. You know, how far back do these Saccharomyces strains go, or even Lactobacillus or Pediococcus? I mean, bacteria that we know will ferment beer. I'm curious how far back it really does go. And I'm just starting to dig into that. There's a little bit of literature that's been done purely on the scientific side, not looking at all at recreating foods, but I think it'd be really cool and a phenomenal curiosity to pull an ice core sample and see if we can reprop yeast that is tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of years old, and see what it would do. You know, we've been able in the modern era to find seeds from archaeological ruin that are 2,000 years old, and we can germinate them and boom, they create a plant, and they've been laying dormant in an archaeological site for 2,000 years, and that's a seed that requires a lot of, you know, nurturing to come back to life. And I wonder when you know, how with these frozen yeast cells, if we can actually do that. And what kind of sparked the idea was what's called the Methuselah tree, which was a date palm that was actually, the seeds were found from Masada near the Dead Sea, right on the outskirts of the Dead Sea, that were about 2,000 years old, and they germinated it and planted it, and boom, it popped up and it's producing dates now. And that's a 2,000 year old seed. What about yeast? You know, another living organism. So, yeah.
That is amazing. Yeah. Well, I wish you luck on that venture.
Thank you.
It sounds like an uphill battle, but
it is. Yeah. I'm trying to make some connections. I'm lucky to be working at a research institution. Our Dean of Arts and Sciences actually works on ice cores in Greenland. And he's a climatologist. And so, I've got some connections. We'll put it that way. We'll see how it turns out. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining me. This was such an eye-opening chat, and your research is really like expanding the boundaries of like what we even think beer can be. And it was so lovely to talk to you. I'm so happy that you were able to make time.
Oh, my pleasure. Yeah, no, thank you for having me on. And I think the future hopefully will be really exciting. Now that I did just launch a few weeks ago, the Beer Archaeologist LLC. So my focus is going to be holistically, I guess, on the education and research and recreation of these historic items. And I hope other people get interested and start doing it as well, because there's a lot out there, a lot of stones to be turned.
Yeah, I think as beer is just getting more and more popular. So I think that there will be future beer archaeologists, hopefully listening to this podcast and being inspired.
I hope so too. Exactly.
Well, I'm looking forward to getting your book, Brewing in the Ancient World. And you guys can follow Travis on Instagram at The Beer Archaeologist to keep up to date on what he's doing. Thanks again for joining me. And that's all I have.
That's great. No, absolutely. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. That's so fascinating. That IPA. Oh my God. Mind blown. I never even thought. One question that I didn't ask because I was afraid it would go like way too long. Did you have to worry about or like think about the salt from the sea getting into the barrels? Did you account for that?
Certainly. We decided not to, only because, so we did consider that. In regards to just kind of where the ship holds were, again, and that's where it depends on if it was above or below the waterline. But it seems like the barrels themselves, I read a little bit on this, and even if it was a 2-month journey, it probably would not have leached into the barrels. They could have been completely coated and caked in the salt, but because the staves are so thick, it probably wouldn't have gotten through. And those bungs, those wooden bungs are actually, they hold pretty darn tight. Because we did it, we were rolling them around. I mean, when we did it, like we replicated day one, getting them on a boat. So in my room that I used to work at the brewery, that's what we did. We literally took them off their racks, filled them, and then rolled them around in the room, and then picked them up with a forklift and put them back on their racks to rest for the night. And nothing ever leaked out of those wooden bungs.
That's crazy.
And so, yeah, they're pretty watertight. But yeah. It was insane. I mean, it was the most stressful project I did. I did not expect it to be.
Yeah, I took you would it on, think it's like, oh, it's an IPA, whatever.
yep, exactly. And it was, oh my God, it was so intense. It was so intense. And yeah, I mean, with the next project, with the program that I'm starting on my own, I'm hoping to do a lot of these with a lot of breweries. And the next project will be Roman Britain, because most of my work has been on, in the last 2 years, I've been in the UK on several research trips working at Hadrian's Wall. And that one's going to be weird too. And there's going to be some stresses with that just because the UK's climate is so strange. Mm-hmm. And Roman barrels were huge. They were not our standard 53-gallon barrels or even wine barrels. They were like twice the size. They were more they were more like puncheons and things like that. And so it's going to be an interesting project, but every one of them, you know, I don't really know exactly what I'm going to get. I have an idea, maybe.
Yeah.
But it's still always like this. Okay, please turn out. Please, you know, come through. Everyone has so far. So
yeah,
we'll see what happens.
Another question just occurred to me. You were talking about getting water from the Thames. Mm-hmm. Wasn't it like super polluted back then?
yeah, exactly. It was. So it was pretty gnarly. I mean, it was, you know, raw sewage is basically just being pumped into the Thames. So
I mean, obviously you didn't want to recreate.
No, we didn't want to do that.
It was just, just occurred to me, like when you were talking about it, I was like, I bet just given the fact that how polluted it was kind of changed things too.
Oh, certainly. And so what I was able to retrieve, and I got back about to the 18 teens. So it was off by a couple of decades of when Bow Brewing started, but Bow Brewing was still producing IPA into that era. Mm-hmm. So another beer historian who actually, it's awesome. He's a food historian for the royal family. So like he actually, that's all he does. He recreates ancient foods and stuff and researches the royal family's kitchen, basically. And he got me in touch with someone over there who could get me records of water chemistry, basically, of the Thames about as far back as they could go. And so what we found as the records started coming in is that it was mostly just adding sulfates mm-hmm. to the water. And certainly the sulfate elevation was probably due to pollution, to sewage that was being dumped. But we then we messed with the calcium ratios and then the sulfates to mimic the Thames water chemistry. And we were able to do that in the brew house at Avery. So, you know, we just had to add sulfates and calcium and we could get it there. And it was fairly, quote, dirty in comparison to obviously Colorado Rocky Mountain filtered water.
You guys have amazing water.
Yeah, it's because we don't even have to, it's so nice. Like we didn't even have a water treatment facility at the brewery. It was great, where a lot of other breweries have to. But what I find interesting about that, and hopefully down the road I'll do this project with a brewery, is IPAs are typically, the history of IPA is typically affiliated with Burton, you know, mm-hmm. and the Trent River. And the reason I did the Thames was because Bow Brewing was the largest exporter of IPAs. And everybody credits the recipe to George Hodgson. So that's why I did it. But Burton is even further dirtied. It's outrageous. The level of calcium in the water on the Trent. I don't even really know what the final product must have been when they first started producing them, because the calcium levels are so high in that water that it would have caused almost immediate yeast flocculation. Like the fermentation would have been so fast and then just boom, drop.
Yeah.
And so I'll have to recreate at some point to see what happened, because maybe, and some have thought that potentially that water chemistry is what gives us the idea that Burton IPAs were more bitter. Mm-hmm. Whereas the London IPA was not, not really bitter at all. So yeah,
I have a pale ale going with a Burton, water profile right now that I'm nice. Curious to see how it turns out.
Yeah, for sure.
It was just like a crapshoot experiment.
Yeah.
So, for sure.
I mean, I think it's just so interesting. I mean, as you know, God, water is just, that's always the hardest part. It really is. I mean, finding the ingredients and stuff and tracking that down can be tedious. But recreating the water chemistry is by far the hardest part. That's why I'm sure you have the Brewing Elements books and the water book. Yeah. I have to reread the chapter like 4 times to be like, did I actually understand what he was saying? You know, because it's so complicated. But yeah, it's pretty crazy. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much. This was awesome. Yeah. Thanks for answering my like random question.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
I usually am just like, oh, I don't have any extra questions, but that was like, oh yeah, I could talk for an hour.
Good. I'm glad to hear it. And thank you for having me on. And big congratulations on launching the podcast. I think that sounds really cool.
Beer is like sunshine for the belly.